for The Joan Quinn Profiles. As an editor for Andy Warhol's Interview, the Los Angeles Herald Examiner, LA Style, and Detour magazines, Joan covered the social set, the Hollywood hotshots, the international art scene, the mysteries of food, the excitement of travel, and the fabulous world of fashion. Joan continues to find creative people on the cutting edge who make things happen. Here's Joan Agajanian Quinn.
Hi, I'm Joan Quinn, and welcome to the Joan Quinn Profiles. Our guests waiting to be profiled are Lynn Neuberg, a chef, and songwriter-musician Shane Alexander. Lynn Neuberg was born and raised in Detroit, Michigan. She went to St. Mary's High School and then the University of Michigan in Ann Arbor. When she moved to California in the 80s, she started her own business designing novelty sportswear for children and for women. How did that take shape?
Well, I knew that I had this artistic need and I had to create. And so I just started to design, and it was something totally different, and it flew. It just totally took off. I was successful immediately, I
have
to say.
Why was it different? What was different about it?
Well, you know what? I think we were doing prints and we were doing novelty sportswear. So the concepts and the colors we were coming up with were fun, but elegant and tastefully done. And so I had people like Nordstrom's and Bloomie's loving that.
And Macy's, Marshall Field.
Absolutely.
You had a big group of department stores buying your things.
Big group, yes, I did.
And then what happened to it?
Well, at one point, everything started to be done in China. And then the business got really dog dirty, so to speak. So I sold the business and I traveled for a little while. And then when I re-earthed, I decided that I wanted to continue in some creative veins.
But you consulted for Saks for a while.
I did. I dressed women.
And then you dressed women.
I dressed women.
Oh, that's good. And then you found your creative vein, cooking.
How did
you started taking classes?
I started taking classes, primarily Italian classes. I went to Massimo and really started to delve into that in
is
a creative way.
Is this Massimo?
That's not Massimo.
Oh,
that
happens
to be Marchese.
Marchese. Well,
Marchese.
We'll wait till Marchese.
We'll wait.
Right. So he was teaching what kind of
Italian? Great Italian cooking. Freshness, the real thing, making your good ragus. He was an excellent teacher, still is.
Where is he?
He's in Los Angeles.
Oh, he's in Los Angeles.
He's in Los Angeles.
And then marriage.
I married a wonderful man, Larry Neuberg, and he and his family have a gold leaf company, and they are major importers of gold leaf.
He had the company when you married him, so you
he did.
Married the gold.
I went for the gold, and I got it, yes.
And then you started taking gilding classes.
Right. I mean, I found it amazing. The first thing I did when I got married is like, can I play with this? Can I explore with this? What can I do? And the first thing I did was a disaster. It was a vase that I gilded for his father. It was terrible.
But did you do any of that before while you were engaged? Were you interested in it before?
Oh, I was very interested. I found everything he did fascinating related to the business.
I see.
And so it was just natural that once I was married, I would delve into it.
But did they do gilding, or was that just what you wanted to do?
No, they taught gilding workshops.
Oh, they did.
And so they had great instructors, we still do, coming from all over, and teaching artisans who are professionals who want to fine-tune their skills, and then also people like me who were green and wanted to learn how to gild.
Well, start with the green person.
Me.
You.
I would be a green person learning to gild.
Okay, so what do you do?
What do you do?
Do we use this? Well,
you look at this, absolutely. These are the colors of gold that are available, and you can see that it goes all the way from silver.
You look at
up
them.
Through, look at this moon gold. Is that just
all
beautiful?
All different colors.
So people think gold is gold, but there's so many different colors and carats of gold. So if you're going to gild something, you first want to decide what color you're going to gild something.
So now, you look at the chart.
You do. You really kind of want to get a feel for that. And then I brought this. I wanted to show you. This is what gold looks like. And this is beaten. Happens to be beaten in Italy. And it's 1/250,000 of an inch.
Hold it against your black.
Or 1 micron.
Right there.
So in other words, 250,000
sheets.
Right?
Yeah.
250,000 sheets of this stacked make 1 inch.
Oh my god.
So this gives you a great idea of just how delicate and temperamental it is. Okay, so this is what the gold looks like.
So this is what they were importing?
This is what we import.
I see.
Gold. Okay. Gold in all colors.
In a pink little slip like that?
Definitely. Comes in a slip like that, and it is carefully placed in between these protective sheets. Oh. There are women in Italy who are taking these pieces of gold with exactly this tool.
Yes.
And they are feeding these pieces of gold in between these sheets.
It's a wooden tool.
It's bamboo.
Oh, bamboo.
It's a very cool little tool.
Can you hold it right there? Because we had it on the camera.
So this is how you would handle the gold.
And why do you use the bamboo?
Your fingers will stick to the gold. If we open this and we touch it, you might as well kiss it goodbye.
Oh, that's it?
That's it. It'll stick to you. So you don't want to touch it.
Is that the first thing you learn in class?
That's one of the first things I learned, definitely. This is called a gilder's tip. And this is made out of squirrel hair. And it is exactly the same size as a piece of gold.
Oh.
So what a gilder would do is take this and touch the gold to the piece of it, and then he can take it and drape it wherever he would want to go. So this is how you would handle your gold. It's called the gilder's tip. And so I learned how to handle the gold, how to prepare a picture frame. That was the first thing I ever gilded.
Let's finish with, you take that.
You take that, and you actually would take this git tip mm-hmm. and lightly get some body oil or any moistness to it, and you open it up, and you actually touch this to the gold, and it lifts it up. I need a little bit more moisture on my skin. I think
so. You have to learn how to do that.
Gilders will put a little bit of Vaseline here.
Ah.
And they go like this, and then they lift it up, and then you would lay it onto the frame.
Okay, so you've laid it onto the frame.
Right.
And what if it gets all matty and mushy, like you just pulled it out of there and it gets mushy and
it will adhere to the frame wherever the frame is damp, and you prepare the frame.
Oh, you prepare the frame first.
You prepare the frame. So if you do mush it and it lays over there twice, you would just brush it off because the gold won't stick to itself.
Oh, it doesn't?
No,
it doesn't.
The gold doesn't stick to itself.
I see.
So this was one of the first things I learned about gold, is a very classic application, which is framing.
Okay, this is the frame, and this is a certain kind of frame, you told me.
This is a classic Italian frame, and it has this work in here is called sgraffito. And sgraffito is when you work with a little tool and you create a little design on your frame.
Did you do the design?
I did.
Oh, you did the design too?
I did that design, and then you burnish it.
Oh.
And that is what the master gilder Bill Adair taught me how to do. So this was my first adventure into using gold.
So this was after you goofed on the
vase. After I goofed on the vase, absolutely.
Then what is the history? They've used this gold all through history.
Through history, the Egyptians were using gold, as we well know. Look at the tombs, King Tut. I mean, so gold has been used as far back as the Egyptians. Gilding artifacts, gilding furniture, gilding lamps, gilding tombs, everything you can think of.
And how is it prepared? I mean, did they prepare it themselves and knew how to prepare it?
Well,
skinny, thin?
Well, people would learn how to pound the gold. The gold is pounded by hand. It's done by machine.
I see.
But centuries ago, this was pounded by hand.
I see.
And the hammer would come down, boom, 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 and they would keep turning it around. This piece of gold, when it was done being pounded, actually looked more like a pie crust. And then the women in the factory cut it with blades that look like double runner ice skates.
Oh.
And they go shh, shh, and then they take their tool and they lift it and they put it in here.
Where are those factories?
Milan, Germany.
Oh.
Milan is outside of Milan, a little bit northeast toward the lake country is really where the temperature's right, everything is environmentally.
Oh, it has to be so special.
Well, you know, we saw how thin it is.
Yeah.
So anything that's moist or you touch it, it's going to evaporate on
you. Okay, so you know how to gild everything.
Okay.
You go in the business, and all of a sudden, you're gilding food.
All of a sudden, we're gilding food. Well, one of the advantages of being married into the gold business is, as a couple, my husband and I would travel, and Larry would always have a booklet of pure gold in his pocket because we would always gild our martinis.
Oh.
So we, and I think you have a photo there.
I do. So.
We were in Santa Fe 3 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And we were with a frame maker. And we were all at the end of the Anasazi, and we whipped out our booklets of gold, and the fellas started taking the sheets like this and laying the entire surface here with a piece of gold. Before the night was out, everybody in the restaurant was, do mine.
And you can eat it. It's edible.
It's edible. And actually, historians believe that there's great medicinal powers with the gold. Bacteria cannot stick to gold.
Oh, that's interesting.
Cannot stick to gold. Skin doctors believe that skin ulcers can be cured by laying a piece of gold on there. So it protects it.
Really?
And no bacteria can go there.
Is that why they make baby objects out of silver? Because bacteria doesn't cling to it, I wonder?
Silver is antibacterial. And I know doctors in the time of the pilgrims were using a silver solution to put in the eyes of babies because babies...
Because it kept the bacteria out.
Absolutely.
Oh, I wondered. So, and the gold has the same
the
kind of
power. The gold has medicinal qualities.
Well, you brought some food for us.
I did.
And you have your gold in different things. I'm going to hold this.
I do.
Because this is a little package that you brought for me, which is a shaker.
Which is a shaker. And as we've been talking about, to handle the gold like this is tedious. So what we did is go to the factory and decide that we should make this user-friendly so that you or I in our kitchen, if we're going to have a party, could very easily open this.
Oh, give me the meat.
This is a filet tartare.
Yes.
And you can very easily just tap it.
This?
Right on the filet. That's right.
Oh, it floats all over.
It goes right to it. Wherever it's going to hit, it's going to stick.
Okay.
You want to tap the bottom of the box.
Okay.
Because if you...
There.
Exactly.
There.
It's so lightweight.
And then look.
I know. It's beautiful.
And the light catches it.
So we did it in a shaker so that we can do this easily. The other thing that we did is prepare this for the end users at home who want to be creative and want to do... Want to gild something and have it look lovely. And
soup. Give me the soup.
I did the soup. And...
The soup is so beautiful.
This is a roasted red pepper and pear soup. And I did the little creme fraiche and did my little zigzag there.
Oh, and then you pick it up
and
with that?
And then I just took my tweezers and plunked it right on there. And it's going to stick wherever it's moist, once again. And this little tweezer is just the little miniature version of the one that the women use in the factory in Italy.
So things don't stick to it. So
exactly.
We have our soup. We have that.
And?
You brought something else that I thought was fabulous looking.
Well, you know, Marchese.
Okay, I can show Marchese now.
Marchese made Milanese risotto, tremendously popular in around Tuscany, by gilding it. And as you can...
Oh, is that what he... That was the specialty?
That was his specialty. And what he has done is take the typical Milanese risotto with saffron and take a sheet of gold.
Oh, but the saffron's very yellow. You want to do that on?
I'm going to do this. Do you want to hold it?
Hold it.
So this is for those that are not faint of heart, that they want to use the whole sheet, which is possible. As you can see... And once it touches anything, there it's going to go.
You just
left it all the way down. There you are. So that is how Marchese will bring it to the table with an entire sheet of gold on his risotto.
That's so beautiful. And let me show. There's a picture of it right here.
And, you know, not everybody wants to do this. I do this constantly, and you can see that I didn't lay it down slowly enough. So... That's why we came up with the idea to make it user-friendly and do it in the shakers. And
that works the best. I'm going to go through these pictures really quickly before we leave because I think it shows all the different things that
there's
you can
There's your petals and the tweezers with a shrimp dish.
Okay.
Again, classic application with chocolate.
Chocolate torte.
There's nothing better than chocolate. And now we know it's good for us, right?
This one.
Fondue, you lay your sheets or your sprinkles or your petals on the fondue, put your piece in and pull it up, and you're gonna see a piece really adheres to it, so.
And?
Sushi, beautiful on sushi. You wanna use your tweezers and you wanna take a petal and place it right on your sushi. Very easy to do.
It's so trendy today, isn't it?
It's trendy.
And thank you for being with
us. It's my pleasure, thank you for having me.
Don't go away, we'll be right back with musician Shane Alexander. Thank you. Hi, I'm Joan Quinn, and welcome back to the Joan Quinn Profiles. I'm with singer, songwriter, guitarist Shane Alexander, who was born in California and raised on the East Coast. Shane was the frontman for the rock band Damone until its disbanding in 2003. Was that your foray into music, or had you been doing something else?
Oh, I've been playing music forever and ever and ever. Damone was a rock band that was the first band I ever fronted. I was a guitarist. Since I was 10, I've been playing guitar, but I kind of started singing a little later. And so I was always like a lead guitar player and stuff in bands, and Damone was the first band that I actually fronted.
So it was already a band, and then you came in and...
No, actually, that was a band with kind of friends from home that transplanted from Pennsylvania to here. And so we were together maybe 4 or 5 years.
That's pretty good, isn't it?
Yeah.
For a beginning, for starting out?
Well, yeah. I'd been out here longer, but those guys came out to play with me. And we did it for about 4 or 5 years and had 2 records and an EP and toured regionally and stuff. And then since that band, I've just been a solo artist.
What was it about that band? What kind of music?
Well, that band was definitely a much bigger, heavier sound than what I'm doing now. We were kind of going for like a Zeppelin meets U2, you know, very grand, yeah.
So how many pieces?
4.
And it was strong enough?
Yeah, oh yeah. And kind of we leaned a little bit improvisational too, so we could stretch out guitar-wise and stuff. And we were a really good band. And the funny thing was, right at the end of our time, we just as the band was getting ready to implode, we were approached by a band on RCA Records in Boston with our same name. And they had just signed their deal, and we were getting ready to break up anyway, and so we ended up selling them our
name. I was going to say, did you sell it? Like Damone, Ramone.
It was all from the movie Fast Times at Ridgemont High is where I got the name.
Oh, I see.
And that was where they got it as well. So.
Oh, that's funny. Were you following a musical path from your family? I mean, did this come, music from your family?
Well, my folks separated really young, and I grew up with my dad's side of the family, and... my mom is actually pretty musical and very involved in the musical community, but she wasn't really in my life for a long time. But my dad just had a really great record collection. So when I was very young, and that combined with a lot of tumultuous years, my dad was remarried a number of times. We moved a lot.
He was?
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. So
what was he doing?
We can laugh now.
Oh, he was in the Army, right?
He was in the Navy, actually.
Oh, he was in the Navy.
And, so yeah, he and my mother were only together a few years.
We can laugh now.
Yeah, we can laugh now.
You know? Did it make a lot of good musical inspirations, you know, writing for you?
You know, as a child who's come from a lot of divorces and a lot of moving around, I think at the time it's really traumatic, but I think in the long run it's actually a benefit. I think people who don't have those kind of obstacles to get around at a young age don't really develop as much of a character sometimes.
And I think that's true too, you know, or any kind of obstacle.
Yeah, you know, and I'm really grateful for all of it, even though it was really rough at the time. But I think that's what kind of pushed me to lock myself in a room and play guitar and, you know, discover my dad's, you know, 8 tracks and then records and stuff. And my dad collected all these old 8 tracks, and like once or twice a year he would sit in the living room and pull out all of these 8 tracks.
Those
and
just, big things, those were really
they
big.
They were like the plastic plug-in
blocks,
deals,
right?
And you know, with a big space in the between
right,
the sides.
Right.
And he just had really great taste, and even though he wasn't a musician, I completely give him credit for kind of pointing me in this direction.
Well, when you left Damone, when that stopped, they say you were a throwback to the 70s for somehow. Is that what happened when you went on your own?
Well, you know, I think like my musical evolution sort of came full circle. When I was very young, like I was really into my dad's collection of like Harry Chapin and Jim Croce and Simon Garfunkel. And then, you know, of course, Black Sabbath and stuff too. So I really got into the rock thing for a long, long time. And then as I started to pull away from the traditional rock band, I kind of really wanted to strip it down to its essence. And so the last 2-3 years, I've toured almost exclusively by myself.
So have you been writing music that's influenced by those people or switching, or did you write all of that kind of thing?
You know, I mean, I don't really have any conscious objective going into writing. It's just, I think all of the influences that you process during the course of your life eventually sort of come back out, and I think that I had such a varied bunch of influences that I don't really sound like one or the other.
Right.
Hopefully I sound original.
But the writing is so poetic, and you talked about the influences, but are there more influences that make it poetic?
I don't really know where they come from. I'm just glad that they come. You know, and I think the trick for me is to just, you have to really make time to write. For me, I can't write in a chaotic, I need a clean room, a quiet place, preferably middle of the night, and completely alone.
And how do you write?
Let it happen.
With your guitar?
Just me and a guitar and maybe some candles, and just let it happen.
Do you write it on paper?
I write lyrics. I don't write music on paper. No.
So you write the lyrics, and then does the music follow?
Usually it's the other way around. Usually I'll start with some kind of guitar part or something, and if it's one of those wonderful divine moments that are kind of rare, like it'll just come out in one fluid thing, you know, and
but
I can write a song
yourself.
In a half an hour. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
In a half an hour?
I'm saying every once in a while, maybe every 10th or 20th song comes that easily, and other ones I toil away for years and years.
I read that you're the master of mid-tempo tune, waxing poetic, striving to find peace. Does that apply to your new CD, Middle Way?
The Middle Way was that is from last year. I just have finished a new record that's not even out yet, so this is still my current record, but the Middle Way is actually a Buddhist term. I've been a Buddhist almost 10 years.
I see. So that's how you pick the...
The title, yeah. And it's like the path between extremes. The Middle Way is the path that leads to enlightenment, right? And, you know, I didn't really set out to write mid-tempo tunes or anything. And I try to vary it for sure, but they just often come out that way.
What is mid-tempo tune? What is a mid-tempo tune? Like between fast and slow?
Yeah. I try to write some toe tappers here and there. My new record is probably even more guilty of that. I just finished this record last week, and that one came out in January. My new one will come out probably April or May.
But who produced this?
A guy named Rogers Masson.
And who else did he produce? He produced a lot of really
great people.
He
worked with Emmylou Harrison Clapton and Dave Wakeling, and he's since moved to Nashville. But
what happens when he's producing you? Does he change things about you? How does he make your sound what you want or what he wants?
I think a producer's job is not what he wants. I think a producer's job is to make sure he coaxes my best performances and the best performances out of everybody else. A producer should just keep the session moving and keep everybody focused. And for me, it's someone to bounce ideas off of. But I try to, you know, I'm a real stickler with keeping my original intent intact. And that's a big thing with being a solo artist versus being in a band, in a traditional band for me anyway. I hated putting all of my songs through a committee of, you know, everybody kind of wanting to put their mark on them. And so with Rogers, I think he just kind of sat back and let it happen. And
what I read was that he uses old equipment.
Yeah.
So that gave you a sound maybe that you were more comfortable with.
Yeah, you know, and my new record, the same thing. In today's world, unfortunately, we're cost prohibitive to use analog to record to tape. You know, it's getting harder and harder to do. So in order to get as much of a timeless sound, I try to use as much vintage gear as possible.
Oh, and talking about vintage, you brought a vintage guitar.
Yeah,
can you
yeah.
hold it up and
yeah.
let us see it?
This is, I have a number of guitars, but this is probably my favorite. It's a 1968 Gibson Southern Jumbo.
And what's so different about it?
Well, it's super awesome.
It's super awesome.
The thing for me about really...
It just looks different.
Well, it's old, and the top is all, it's called spiderwebbed or checked because the finish starts to break up and crack as the moisture is taken out of the wood over time. And so for me, I really like old guitars because they're really dried out. They don't weigh anything, and they just have more of a woody sound. And new guitars just sound too kind of lacquered and nice, and these have a little bit more character.
How many do you have?
22.
Where do you find them?
Wherever I can. I've actually had really good luck with eBay, although, you
really?
Know, it's like I'm afraid to endorse that because people can get ripped off, but I've probably got 9 or 10 guitars from eBay.
But do people throw them away? Is that it? Or sell them? Or can you find them in pawn shops?
I'm completely addicted to pawn shops. Actually, there's one right down the street from here that I always stick my head in. But I think, again, with eBay, the market price has become kind of more set since it's a buyer's market, you know.
So for collecting,
it's not as easy to find something that's worth a lot of money that they don't know it's worth a lot of money.
Does it change the picking? I think you have a certain picking style. Does it matter with what kind of guitar you're using?
Actually, it does. This guitar is actually more of a strummer with a pick, but I do finger pick quite a bit in the last few years. I grew out my horrible, scary-looking nails.
Oh, so you have these scary nails?
Yeah, yeah. And I just think once I had them, it just sort of became an extension of my hand, and now I'm sort of afraid to be without them. And it's only been a hassle once in the middle of my last record. I broke a nail, like, right on the way to the...
What happened?
It's, like, such an embarrassing thing for a man to say, but... basically, we didn't track for, like, a week on as far... Because it was a solo acoustic piece, right?
Couldn't you use a pick?
Not for that kind of a performance. For other songs, sure. But and I know some guys go for the acrylics and stuff like that.
I was going to say, couldn't you glue it on?
You know, I went to one place in Westwood trying to, like, can you help me? And they're just... They were not into that. Yeah, they were no help.
You have distribution in Europe, and you also perform there, right?
Yeah, right around maybe last February or March.
I'll hold this up, because this is...
Yeah, those are actually pictures from a festival I played in Holland in November called Roots of Heaven. And I had a friend named Chris Laterzo, who's a songwriter who lives in Venice, and he toured over there. In the Netherlands quite a bit, and so he kind of gave me a few people to get in touch with, and so I started to send the record over, and I managed to get really good press, and I managed to get national airplay, and so that sort of precipitated me getting this distribution deal in Amsterdam. And
do you like going there?
Oh, it's awesome.
Are your audiences different?
You know, I think it helped that I got national, obviously it'll right. help anywhere to get national radio play. But I managed to kind of hit the ground running there. I did two or three national radio interviews and television and the one festival. And like just my first trip over, I managed to play really full rooms that knew who I was. So it was very rewarding, you know, as an independent artist. And so I had a great time there. And I'm actually going back in April for a few weeks. We've got about 5 or 6 shows confirmed. It'll probably end up being another dozen shows.
Fabulous.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Thanks for having.
Thank you, Shane, for being here. And you keep riding to 777 South Figueroa, 44th floor, Los Angeles, 90017. See you next time.
Thank you.